Hello, this is Sunny from My Happy Space. Welcome back at my channel. We are going to do our meditation seed for this week's memory verse, which is Psalm 86 verse 11. An absolutely stunning verse. There's so much to be found from this verse. So with further ado, let's get into it. If you want to know all the information where I get this from, go to my first video in the series. I always go every month, the first video of the month, I go a little bit more in detail. The app is called Bible Hub. So this is the app I use, or I use the normal Bible, ESV, I use Google, whatever is available for me. So first of all, I write down the verse. We are memorizing the ESV version, so this is obviously our verse. I usually choose the NIV and the NLT, because they just stand out for me. The one is definitely more thought for thought, the other one is a thought for word translation, and this one is a word for word translation, the ESV. So you get different translations. So the NIV says, teach me your way, O Lord, or just Lord, that I may rely on your faithfulness instead of that I walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. So instead of a united heart or unite heart, an undivided heart. The NLT says, teach me your way, O Lord, that I may live according to your truth. Grant me purity of heart so that I may honor you. So that's also beautiful. Instead of fear, honor. So this is the five W's and H's, and that is who wrote it, context and things like that. David wrote the psalm. The context is David is asking for God's help, trusting him that he needs to be rescued. When it was written, nobody's sure. I just put the general one there for the general Psalms 979 BC. But we know the Psalms was written from David or up to after exile. So it's a combination of many times. Where did it go? Obviously, I always say to God, because David wrote this prayer for the God, and obviously the congregation, and ultimately for us also. Why was it written? Nobody knows exactly sure on what situation he was. Was he fleeing from Saul? Was he fleeing from Absalom? But he's just talking about these bandits of people chasing him. So obviously he was in dire straits. And what does it say about God? I just said, God, there is a way. God has got a way. He's got truth. And his name needs to be feared. And he teaches me to do things. So that's what I learned about God. So now I'm going to go to the cross references. But actually, before we go to the cross references, let's read the Bible. It's interesting. Remember, our first verse was, incline my heart, yet is incline your ear. And it's interesting, in the New King James Version, it says, bow down, O Lord. So it's almost like we know it's an expression. It's not really God, don't really bow down, but it's just like bow down, take attention, I've inclined my ear to you. So I'm just quickly going to read. I probably won't read all of it, or I might, but yeah, I'll go quickly over it. So he said, incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am godly. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. So here David is asking, obviously, he first of all says, I'm poor and needy. I'm in a desperate situation of I need help. Preserve my life, for I'm godly. The other translation says righteous. I mean, obviously, no, David didn't think he was God or perfect. He was just in right standing with God. And he, in comparison with other people, he was in right standing with God. So that's what he said. He is a man who wants to honor God. So verse 14, it says, O God, because the reason is, because, O God, insolent men have risen up against me. A band of ruthless men seek my life, and they do not set you before them. So this is the reason why he's asking God earnestly for help. And he brings his case before the Lord. And when I listened to David Guzik's sermon, he said that we often forget to bring our case before the Lord. And say, Lord Jesus, this is the reason why I need help. Out of my perspective, this is the reason. But I come to you needy and trusting you. And I remind you of who you are. That we can read a little bit later. Then be gracious. Now David is reminding God of who he is. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all day. He is dependent and desperate. gladden the soul of your servant. For to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. So he said, please gladden me. So the appeal for God's help is because he is in right standing with God. We are in right standing with God because of what Jesus done on the cross. You are my God, reminding God that you are my God, that I trust you, that I trust you all day long, and you're gracious, reminding God of who he is. So his basis of asking God for help is not looking to who he is, that he's so wonderful, but reminding himself and God of who he is. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. So this is becoming personal. He said, please listen to me. I need help. I need answers. There is none like you among gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you've made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. So here David is reminding himself yet again about God, this personal God who he personally can call upon. This personal God doesn't compare to any other God. There is no other God beside the God of Israel, the true God. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. So yet again, as I said, he's reminding God of who he is. Yet again, then he goes personal again. This big, amazing God, personal, global, almighty. And then he goes personal again. Teach me, that's our verse, obviously. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. And David Kuzik said this verse, or this psalm, is David used the word Adonai, which is Lord, which is a capital L, but the rest of the letters is spelled normally. That is Adonai, my master. I'm your servant, my master. And then actually in our verse, he used the word Yahweh. Teach me your ways, O Yahweh, because he wants to recognize that God is the covenant God. He wants to be taught his ways, that I might walk in your truth. And it just really reminds me of John 14:16, one of our memory verses we done last year. I am the way and the truth. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14:16. So 14:6. So that is what, there is not just one truth. There is not many truths. There is just one truth. There's not many ways. I know the NIV says, or no, the NLT said, teach me your ways. But none of the other translations, they all just talk, teach me your way. There is one way, and that is the way through Jesus Christ. The right way to live your life, or the ungodly way to live your life. And then he talked about giving thanks to you, O Lord, my God. With my voice and heart, I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of soul. And that's past tense. So he's looking back and see what God has done in the past. And he's holding onto that promises that God can do it again. And he's talking here about unite my heart. And David Guzik said, it's almost like he's realizing to unite my heart to fear God's name. I need to give thanks to God and give glory to God. I give thanks to you and I will glorify your name. So for us to get to that point that we fear God, that we understand who he is, we need to start praising him and thanking him for all he's done. Because we remind ourselves of how great he is, like David do here in these verses. And then, as I said, he's reminded God about his steadfast love. Oh God, insolent men have risen against me. Here it talks about the verse 14, that people has risen against him and they haven't set you before them. They do not set you before them, meaning they don't know you, they don't fear you, they don't recognize you. But you, God, O Lord, is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. It's the same prayer that Moses prayed in Exodus 34:16, when he was sort of in the cleft of the rock. So that is, David knew the word of God. He recalled the word of God. And that is, when we want to have a good prayer life, is we read the word of God. We listen to and see what the Lord wants us to know about it. And then we pray the word of God back to God. And that is the most powerful prayers we can do. And that's exactly what David did here. Turn to me, gracious to Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign of your favor, that those who hate me may see and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. So show me your faithfulness today during the day, as I go about my life. So so this is a beautiful, beautiful prayer of David. It's a prayer of trusting God, of desperation, that God is the only one that he trusts, and that he just wants to give God the glory for who he is, and he tapped into the fact of who God is. So I hope that was useful to you. So the words I chose is very nice words. This is a nice, first map to do if you haven't done one before. This nice chunky word. So I've choose teat. To teat is to throw, to shoot, archer shot, instruct, directed, cast, have set a point, have set a point out. Now, teat is interesting. Sin is missing the mark. Like, means if you shoot an arrow, you miss the mark. Now, teat is to throw and to shoot. I don't know really if there's any correlation between that, but it almost makes sense to me. If the opposite fun of sin, missing the mark, the remedy for that is to be taught, to be shown where we gone wrong. Like, as I said, to throw, and to me is to throw and to shoot, is almost to show you how to do it, to train you. Maybe that is the only concept they could think of, what the word train mean in those days, or in the Hebrew times, is treating somebody as skill. So as I say, and instruct and cast, point out. So point out to me your way. Throw, show me your way, instruct me your way. And cast, it's like casting stones almost, like throw, show it out there to me your way. Now way, we've done many times, we've looked up way when we looked at Psalm 1. You know, the way of the righteous. We looked obviously at John 14, verse 6. We've looked at that way. So it's more or less the same way. The difference between way and walk. Way is the general direction you are needing to walk. Your road, your journey, your distance, your actions, your conduct, your course, your practice, what you practice. So show me the direction I need to go. Course of how I need to walk my life, how I need to conduct my life, my actions, the journey I need to go on. Then walk is actually the practical action of walking, to walk, access, accompany, follow. So this is the action you need to do, the physical action. Way is more the pathway you need to go, the direction you need to go in. So yes, we need the direction we need to go in, but then we also need the action, how to walk, to who's accompany us, how do we act, who do we follow. That's what it is. Truth is firmness, faithfulness, lasting, right. The root words is aman, to confirm, to believe, to endure, to establish. Put your trust in it and verify. I mean, we know all, if you verified your account, if you're a celebrity, or these days you don't even need to be a celebrity anymore to have a verified account on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. But that means you're legit. You are the one who it is. Truth is you're legit. This is the truth. There's nothing else. There is only truth. And we know Jesus is not, he is not just pointing us to truth. He is truth. He is what it means to be truth. And then unite is to be united, to join, to make or declare one. And then there was just one verse, a cross-reference verse that stood out for me, Jeremiah 32, verse 39, which says, I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for their own good and the good of their children after them. So beautiful. Here it talks again about fear him, have respect and awe of him, and to give a one heart. So that is what it means to be united, to have a one heart and a one purpose. So that's beautiful. And then fear, we know it's to be in awe of God, to revere God, to what God says is heavy. It takes precedent over anything else. I'll fear God, not man. What God says is more important than what man says, and that is what fear means. And as I said in this bit also, the reason why he wants to give them a one heart and a united heart is that they may fear me forever. And that should be our prayer also, that we will fear God forever. Then there was beautiful cross references, which I will quickly show you in the Bible Hub. It's easier because otherwise I don't have to look for all the verses. Obviously, here the cross references, there's sort of a general cross reference, and then there's a cross reference for each word, like Vincent teats. Lead me, O Lord, in the righteousness because of mine enemies. Make thy way straight before my face. Psalm 5:8. So lead me in your righteousness. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Psalm 25 and Psalm 27, verse 11. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies. That's beautiful. This is an easy, plain path. And then I have chosen the way of truth. Thy judgments have I laid before me. So Psalm 119, verse 30, that's also beautiful. So this is usually where I get my cross references. So beautiful cross references. You can obviously go as deep as you want and make a whole study about what it means to fear the Lord, what it means to be united and one mind. So I hope that was useful. I'll definitely talk to you on Friday when I do an intro in my Bible. I hope you have a great week so far. And God bless you. Bye-bye.